okay, let's talk about MALS, median arcuate ligament syndrome. Before we talk about any disease process, we have to know the anatomy. So we have a model here of the upper GI tract. So this would be the esophagus here. This is the stomach. This is the beginning of the small intestine called the duodenum. Back here, you have the aorta. On top of all this is the diaphragm. Coming off the diaphragm is a ligament called the median arcuate ligament, which sits right here between the esophagus and the aorta. If that ligament is too low, possibly because the diaphragm is too low, and if it's compressing this area where you have the celiac artery and the celiac ganglion nerve plexus, if you have that compression with the symptoms that might go with that compression, you might say that you have what's called median arcuate ligament syndrome. So what are the symptoms of MALS? Some are vague, but after years of experience seeing and talking to 5 to 15 patients a week with MALS, there are definitely some very specific symptoms and signs. MALS is epigastric pain. It's pain right below your sternum that typically radiates down the left subcostal margin or the left rib cage. Most patients describe it either as a squeezing pain or a stabbing pain. The pain is debilitating, and the pain gets worse with anything and everything you eat or drink. That's very unique to MALS. It's not what you eat, but it's how much. That pain is so debilitating after eating that patients develop what's called cytophobia. They get a fear of eating, to the point of which, by the time they find somebody who understands the disease process, that patient could have lost anywhere between 10 to 20 to 50 to even 100 pounds. The pain is quick. It typically comes on within 5 to 20 minutes of eating. Most patients will say that it happens as they're eating. There's a lot of associated conditions that come along with MALS. About 50% of our patients with MALS have POTS. A good portion of our patients, about a quarter of our patients, have Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, MCAS, which is mast cell activation syndrome, and a host of other GI problems that come with all that. Now, MALS is a very difficult diagnosis to make, so the story always matters. You have to spend time listening to each patient's story and finding out how they got to where they are up until that date. There's a number of studies that we get on each of these patients. Every patient gets an upper endoscopy, a CT scan with IV contrast, a dynamic duplex ultrasound that checks the velocity of the celiac artery, a gastric emptying study to see how well the stomach empties, and most important is the celiac nerve block. So why do we get a celiac nerve block? In my strong opinion, a very big component of MALS is the neurogenic component, the impingement or compression of the nerve. So it's not just the artery that's being compressed. In fact, I think a lot of this is because of the nerve impingement from the median arcuate ligament. So we ask all our patients to get what's called a celiac ganglion nerve block. So a pain doctor who specializes in pain, somebody who does epidurals, typically goes in from the back, puts a needle in, and numbs up that area with numbing medication and steroids. And we ask that patients immediately go and test to see if it's made things better. So we ask patients to drink, to eat, and if that debilitating pain has gone away for at least 6 hours, that's a very strong indicator that one, you have MALS, and two, that surgery will make you better. As far as our outcomes, so I've done over 150 of these operations. We're publishing our first 100 series of patients. 83% of patients who have undergone MALS surgery with me have gotten significant improvement. Only 5 patients, 5 out of 100 or 5%, have had no improvement. And there's a small mixture of patients that have had some improvement, but usually have other GI issues that need to be addressed. Fortunate to be able to do all these operations without any mortalities. No patient has ever died, and I'm very superstitious, so I'll be knocking on wood, but no patient has ever died in my hands when I've done this operation. It's a very scary operation. You have to know what you're doing. There's a learning curve associated with the surgery. The one thing that's unique about me is I do this operation robotically with small incisions. This operation does not have to be done open. There's nothing that can't be done robotic that is done open, and it's very rare. I've only had 2 patients that we've had to convert to open surgery. So over 99% of patients who have undergone surgery with me we've been able to complete it from beginning to end robotically. So as far as post-operatively, we are very hands-on on our patients. We basically become friends for life. So most of our patients come from out of state. I always want to see the patients before they go back, usually within 1 week of surgery. And then we do long-term follow-up. So we do a 6 week, a 12 week, which is 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, 1 year, and once a year after that. If you are not doing well, we want to know because we can figure out a way to make things better for you.